Father, thank you for the afternoon. Help us to understand this section about the unctuals and how we can appreciate the scripture that we have in our hands in our own language. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's go over the quiz from last week. Everything's running now?
Oh, sorry.
All right. Good. Let's go question number one, Bill.
Why were so many manuscripts of the New Testament not used because of corruption and subsequent disuse?
Right. They weren't used, and so that's why, you know, they were corrupt. And number two, Mom, go ahead.
What is papyrus? It's made from papyrus plant. What was one of its uses? Used to write the books of the Bible. Maybe the first question isn't answered right.
Okay, no, that's good. It's that's good. I'll take that. Tammy, number three, please.
What is the vellum? Animal skins. And what was one of its uses? As a paper for writing the scriptures.
Good. Mrs. Grummer, Anna, number four, please.
How many papyrus fragments have been discovered, and where were some of these fragments discovered? Well, at the time of the writing of Revelation 7, I think there were eight. That have been discovered.
88, right? 88.
That's what I meant.
Yeah, I know that.
Some of my pen slipped. And some of them were discovered in Alexandria, I suppose. Perhaps.
Outside of Egypt, yeah. In Egypt,
oh,
yeah.
Alexandria.
Outside of Cairo, rather. 120 miles outside of Cairo.
Okay, I'm sorry. Wrong city in Egypt.
It's okay. Number five, Mrs. Gorman.
More like 100 and some now, aren't there?
Yes, there's more. Number five, Mrs. Grummer.
What source did Stuart Custer base his list of papyri? Taken from the 26th edition of the Nestle-Aland Greek New Testament.
That's right.
In the New Testament.
In the 26th edition. Jacob, the next question, please.
How large is papyri 52? Just a fragment.
Okay, it's just a little small, little fragment, isn't it? Number seven, Bill.
What manuscripts are the two pillars of the revised text of Westcott and Hort? That would be Vaticanus and Sinaiticus.
That's right. And what are catalog number letters, Mom?
How many so-called readings?
The catalog identifications of B.
I don't think I understand.
Okay. You take the next question, please.
How many so-called reading papyrus support the Vaticanus kind of text? That's the right question.
Yes,
And two, how many of the 80, 13 out of 80, how many of the 88 papyri actually lend any support to the Westcott and Hort text type? Nine. I don't know if these are answers are right or not.
Good. Nine. What's the second part?
Nine
is the first part. What's the second part?
She had it the other way around.
Yeah, we had it backwards. Okay, we'll book set it backwards.
Oh, okay.
But it's really, it is a confusing question. I agree with that. Okay. When we have these two part questions, they can become very 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 confusing. I'm sorry about that. I gotta. Eliminate the two-part questions.
13 out of 80 is not correct for number one.
How many so-called readings support the Vaticanus text type? Nine.
Oh, I have.
How many eight of the 88 papyri actually lead any support?
Okay.
Plus or minus 13.
That's confusing. Okay.
Yes, it's confusing. I'm sorry. Oh. These two-part questions I have to get rid of. We'll have a longer quiz.
People that read them that don't know what they're doing.
No. It's nothing to do with that. Tammy, number nine, please.
What text do P45, P46, P66, and P75 lend the greatest support to the Sinaiticus and Vaticanus? And two, what papyri are the favorite sons of a highly treasured and highly treasured by the modern textual critic, P45, P46, P66, and P77.
Number 10, Nana. I mean, Mom, go ahead.
Is that right?
Well, I had a different answer, but my answer was probably...
I'm a little mixed up.
Yes,
because you had the answer in part one of the question. I mean, but what was your answer?
Well, I thought when I was looking at it, it was the even though they're favored by the one group, when you look at it, it's the favors of text receptus. You know, in reality, but I guess I got to look at that closer since no one got that answer. So I got to mixed up myself.
What papyri are the favorite sons of highly treasured?
No, part one. Part two is correct. Part two is correct. Clearly, the answer is in part.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I get it.
Okay.
Yeah, you're right.
Mom, go ahead.
What's your first answer to part one?
Yeah, what's your part one?
Alexandrian. I don't know the answers to begin with.
Okay.
What is supposed to be the answer to one?
You just said that.
I know I did, but I don't remember.
If you look at the page, or whatever page this is, from page 107, it says, with regard to distinctive differences of each of the four papyri given greater support to the TR than to the Vaticanus or Sinaiticus. P45 and P46 and P66 and P75.
So you were going to tell me I was wrong.
Sinaiticus, it came out. It came out with a follow-up question.
Why don't you just say... The answer is such and such.
I'm looking.
The answer is yet.
The answer is the Texas Receptus.
It's not Alexandrian.
No, I'm looking for the TR.
Okay, I'll figure that out.
You would think they would give the greater support for the other side, but it doesn't. When you can do a comparison.
Yeah, they somehow think it does.
You know.
It supports their position.
And number 10, please.
What Pyrrhus omits, and he saith unto them, behold the man. What is the false Pyrrhuses?
Okay.
Papyri.
Pick a number between...
I don't know.
P60...
I have two answers for this.
P66.
But I thought P66, we just discussed...
It's P60, it. Isn't that? On page 180?
P66.
Okay, look at the bottom of the page.
108.
Look at the bottom of...
I have 108 and P66.
And on the bottom of page 107, it says... bottom of page 106... the bottom of 107 going to 108, it says there are serious errors in Papyrus 66. For example, in 1 John 19:5, Papyrus 60 omits the following famous sentence.
No, it says... 66.
It says 66 there?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm reading it wrong. I'm sorry.
It says Papyrus 66. Okay.
So it's 66. P66 is the right answer.
Your book doesn't say that?
I have a wrong answer. I have a wrong tabulation in my notes here.
I believe that.
I don't think so.
Well, I have 108XX and P66.
Okay, P66 is the right answer.
And I have 108.
It was on page 108.
Oh, that's what it is.
Okay.
Somebody kept telling 107, and after a while.
Okay, who gave the answer to page 110? From the number of number 10. Who is number 10?
Well, I was supposed to answer, but I didn't really.
Okay.
Well, I'm confused now. P66.
Oh. Yeah, the answer is P66.
But I thought P66 supported. Lends the greatest support to the Texas Receptus.
Okay.
Why is running around omitting things?
Because it still follows some of the readings of
it. Even with its flaws, and it still is more supportive of the TR than of the other one.
Okay.
In other words, you take number 11, and I'm sorry for stealing that one from you.
No, you didn't steal it because I don't know the answer to these. Really,
okay.
Because I didn't have my book either. I didn't
organize. You don't have it today?
No.
This may be showing the nature of corruption.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're not seeing all of the word. You're not seeing a different text from the Textus Receptus. You're seeing changes in the corrupt text. Words deleted, mostly. Some words, there's substitutions. Some words were replaced, but there's a lot of deletions.
Right.
So even though the modern textual critic is using it for their modern translations, overall the text itself is still closer to the TR because of what it didn't do.
That's right. Mm-hmm. What it didn't do. Good observation, Bill. And it's they're trying to be, especially in Alexandria, they did what they could to try to correct it, but even they failed ultimately. Although the so-called scholars today want to think that better for some reason.
It's especially sneaky.
Yeah, it is sneaky. Extra sneaky.
Yeah.
Mrs. Grummer, are you getting number 11, please?
Is she there?
She has to get herself off mute. Jacob, please take your mother off mute. And
he probably likes her.
She's her turn to answer question 11.
Okay. What face does papyri P5 and P77 alter? I've got Christ, sinless, and perfect humanity.
Okay, so they changed Son of God to the Chosen One. So.
Right.
They're question. They're attacking
his deity
and humanity there. Jacob, number 12, please.
Which papyri moved part of John 3:13?
P66 and 75. Sorry, P66 and P75. Bill number 13, please.
Which papyrus changes Son of the Living God to the Holy One? That would be P75.
Good. Mom, 14, please.
What does papyrus P75 do with John 9:38-39? Change the Son of God to Son of Man.
Well, John...
Is that wrong? Probably is.
It admits it. And it's part of it, at least, not all of it.
Yeah, it was part of it.
Part of it.
Verse 39.
Verse 39.
Why did I change the Son of Man? Why did I say
just
that?
Because that's John 9:35.
So it admits verse 39.
Oh, okay.
It doesn't admit the whole thing. If you look at the actual Bible, it only omits the words that Dr. Mormon quoted.
Okay, and he said, Lord, I believe, and he worships him. Yes, that's
what was eliminated.
Yes. So it eliminates those that phrase there, that part of the verse.
Can you give me the right answer? I know she tried to tell me, but I didn't get it.
Verse 39.
14.
Well, I guess I was looking for what phrase does it emit? And it emits, and he said, Lord, I believe, and he worshipped him. That's what's emitted.
Yeah, and that's actually only on John
9:38. 38, okay. No, nothing with 39. Although, I wonder if it actually omits...
It omits verse 39.
It omits all of 39.
Oh, okay.
And part of 38.
It doesn't omit, and he said, Lord, I believe, and he worshipped him. It doesn't omit that.
It omits verse 39.
It omits verse 39.
I looked it up,
and it omits verse 39.
It omits 39. So it omits 39.
So I crossed that out, and he said, I don't know what the answer is. Oh, never mind. Go ahead.
Omits John 9:39. Okay. 15, please. I guess that's your question on...
Hey, Pastor Dan.
Jacob.
She just did one.
Oh, you're...
This question 13, which this papyrus changed the Son of the Living God to the Holy One?
Yes.
The answer is P75.
P75.
69 here. It's the third scripture down on page 108. Now I think right, Son of the Living God, P75 changes the Holy One.
Okay. That's what.
That's what the answer 13 is. Instead of 9 over there in chapter 9, that's for a different...
We were talking about question 14, Jacob, but question 13 is
P75. Oh, okay, because the delay probably got me. Sorry about that.
That's okay. It gets me. It's getting me too, Jacob, and I'm a lot closer here.
I'm working here on the computer.
Okay.
Sorry about that, Pastor.
It's okay. Not a problem. I'll tell you number 15, please. 15, 1-5.
Which papyri changed the only begotten Son to the only begotten God? P66 and P77.
Okay, that's right. Okay, Anna, number 16, please.
Who taught that there were various levels of spiritual beings? What does that mean?
The question number 16, who taught that there were various levels of spiritual beings? In other words, like
Mormons.
Like an evolution, you know, you're down here, you're a little small little fourth person on the totem pole, then you gradually, like the Wilson, this is what the Mormons believe.
Yeah.
It's also New Age.
New Age belief.
I thought it was Gnostics.
Also, we're trying
right,
to keep
though.
My answer is Gnostics.
It's all the same.
Gnostics, it's all the same.
You should be as God.
It all comes from the same place.
So. All right, Mrs. Grummer, take that next one, please.
Hello, did you ask the follow-up
question? Yes, please. Take the next question there.
Which one was
number 17, please.
17. What did the editor of P45 prefer? He prefers a simple to the compound word. He shortens the text in at least 50 places in singular readings alone.
So he liked that shorter reading, did he not? Jacob, number 18, please.
Papyri readings did H.A. Sturtz discover supported the Textus Receptus? Over
5,000? 150 distinct
presenting. I'm looking for 150 distinct presenting readings, yes.
Anyway.
Tammy.
I also had 17. That he copied, it would do his copying of phrases and clauses. I mean, I know you were asking that question that was what Mrs. Skrummer gave, but I didn't get to that part of the textbook, so I wasn't even thinking about that.
Yeah, so he did have those different systems of clauses, phrases, and some other, even down to the letters, I think he was they were doing some odd things.
He wasn't doing the letters.
Oh, somebody else was. Okay.
Yeah. That was P75. He was doing phrases and clauses.
Number 19, please.
What percentage of New Testament is supported by existing papyri? 30%.
30%. Number 20, Mom.
Where are we?
Number 20.
Oh, okay. What do you think about the case many pro-origin scholars use for blindly accepting papyri that differ so greatly with the Textus Receptus? I have to go to the bottom of page 11. If someone else wants to view it, it's fine with me.
No, you can do it. It's fine.
I wonder how it could be page 11.
Page 111?
I think I'm wrong.
No,
let someone else answer this.
Okay. Well, Tammy, what answer do you have for 11?
Okay.
I mean, number 10.
I'm not sure
number
what
20.
What I said makes sense. Okay.
It makes sense.
I know what I had in my head makes sense, but it's
well, then
had trouble.
Tell me what you have in your head.
I'm not sure if I can get it out. I was sort of being sarcastic in my comments. And if I say it that way, I'm not sure if everyone will get what I'm saying.
Okay.
Go ahead. But if a minority of texts rule, and the mere mention of a Vatican or B, a Sinaiticus Aleph reading in the most important papyri supporting them, even though less than less support than for the TR readings, proves that B and Aleph were supported by the papyri and were hence the oldest and best. Further understanding of this isn't making any grammatical sense, but in other words, it's like then you need some further understanding of what majority rules mean.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so it was just, I think it's rather humorous that they think that 13 out of 88 papyri
right. mm-hmm.
are sufficient.
It is humorous. You're right.
And, if in the time of greatest corruption of scriptures, the TR is testified to, and we see more than BNL. Okay, I'm not sure what I was saying. I know what I was saying, but I don't know what I was saying.
Monica.
I had a page turned back, and I made it 11-700 on it. The magnitude of this vindication can be more fully appreciated by recalling that only about 30% of the New Testament has early papyrus attestation, and much of the 30% has only one papyrus. Where more than one covers a stretch of text, each new manuscript discovered vindicates Byzantine reading, extrapolating from the behavior of those in hand. We had at least three papyri covering all parts of the New Testament. Almost all of the 5,000 plus Byzantine readings rejected by the critical eclectic texts would be vindicated by an early papyrus. I don't know what I read, but I read
it. Good. Thank you for reading that. Anna, number 20, please.
Seem to not want to accept the truth.
That's right. That's very sad, isn't it? They don't want to accept the truth.
Good. She got that.
All right, Mrs. Grummer, number 20, please. Number 20, Mrs. Grummer. And Jacob, what do you get for number 20?
I like what Naomi said.
Yes.
Extrapolation on that.
Mm-hmm.
So she did say she didn't really know what she was talking about, but it sounded good to me. I wish she would have made it clearer. But not clear. It was pretty clear to me. It's just there's more that she wanted to build on it. I kind of know it. Anyway, I'm done.
All right, Bill, number 20, please.
Okay, I wrote two words down for it, but it really requires a little bit more explanation.
Okay.
I say misguided deduction.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And, a person is reading scripture, they tend to interpret things humanistically. They tend to interpret the way they want it to be. They see what they want to see. And they're not really listening. When we're reading scripture, we should be listening to the Lord, because He's the one that's speaking. And all of these people that are have these new theologies and all of this, the emerging church and all this other mm-hmm. garbage that's out there, these are people that are speaking strictly from their own heart, their own wishes, mm-hmm. their own wills. One person told me that I don't have any imagination because I don't see into Scripture the way he does. And I was thinking to myself, hallelujah. But I think it's such a common problem. You hear it. You hear it in people mm-hmm. talk.
Yeah.
You hear it. You hear it all over the place.
Right.
Mm-hmm. There should be reverence for each word of God, because that's what's important. It's not what I think.
Mm-hmm.
If I think something is different than what's in Scripture, then I'm the one that's wrong, and I've got to correct myself.
Yes, that's right. That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Good. All right, let's look at the new section here. Thank you for all those answers to that quiz. Next section here is a survey of the Unshul manuscripts. Unshul manuscripts are he's going to talk about the five favorite Unshul manuscripts of the other side.
Here we go again.
But we have an Unshul manuscript. Unshul's or manuscripts. In the ancient manuscripts, you'll see them written in all capital letters without any spaces. And there was a certain structure to it, but still written in all capital letters with no spaces. One thing to write in all capital letters for us to read it, but then when you have no spaces.
Or punctuation.
Or punctuation, yes, right. It could be done. You can look at something, if you're familiar with the language, you could see it in most instances. Sometimes two words go together, sometimes they can form another word at the end, or whatever it might be, and you may get the wrong word. But ancient manuscripts. Now, Quran says there's 267 of them, at least at the writing of work here. Yeah, and then you have five, okay. And we have also images, the minuscules. Now, the minuscules are small letters, lowercase letters. Uncials are capital case. Minuscules are lowercase letters. He says the uncials were used first from the Mormons, from the 4th to the 10th century. Minuscules were used a little bit later from the 9th to the 16th century. Plus, if you realize there's a 19th, 8th, 20th century poet, I think. His name is E.E. Cummings. He writes in all lowercase, but he has spaces in his work. But nonetheless, so we have the characteristics of the uncials. Again, it's all capital letters. And they suspect the date of the uncials from the 4th to the 10th centuries. And then we have the minuscules, who's dated to that dates from the 9th to the 16th century, which is all lowercase. And again, everything all runs together. I think he had an example there someplace in the book of things running together, like God so loved the world. He mentions over there on page 111. Now, on page 111, he gives an example of the...
It's in parentheses. It's in capital letters there. At the end of the first paragraph. First full paragraph.
You see it there?
The end of the first paragraph in 113.
The first full paragraph. The one that's
Based on right when it's...
No.
I'm trying, he's giving an example.
Page
111. Oh, I'm on 113.
Okay. Okay. Good. Sorry, I thought we passed
111. Well, no, we were talking about...
Okay.
It was a comment. I was trying to make a quick passing comment. Didn't
well,
even make
I
a big,
see it. I see it.
You see that there? See? And we can, if you know anything else, you can read that together. You can read that pretty well.
That's because we know what it says.
You know, we know what it says, but we can see it.
Well, any language we would know,
you
would be able to identify.
Yeah, we should be able
to read.
And so that, this is the characteristic of uncials, all capital letters. Now, what would you say the characteristics of minuscules were, Mom?
I guess they're little letters.
Little letters, that's right. Tammy.
I have a question. I'm not sure if you're going to discuss this, but when he's talking about uncia and 12th part, and then he talks about a letter would take up a 12th part of a column. Is he mean row? A 12th part of a row, and there's 12 letters in a row?
Well, it's...
Is he saying... I'm not understanding that.
I think... I'll get to that in a moment
okay,
here.
Okay, that's fine.
But, not in great detail, but in a little detail. I mean, maybe not very much, maybe minuscule detail.
Just say answer my question.
Okay, I'll try to. and so we have, again... As Tammy said at the beginning, here we go again, because the uncial manuscripts, again, there's greater agreement with the TR than with the other texts. And so this is why they have to do the family concept. This is why they have the invented to create the families. Because if they didn't create the families, then they would lose all the time. Because 15% if 85 or over, taking all the manuscripts, all the types of manuscripts, all the different sorts of them, there's over 85% of those manuscripts are TR supported, and 15% are on the other texts, the origin texts, the text of origin, which Westcott Hort have embraced. And so, getting to this question that Tammy was asking about, it has. again, our knowledge is limited in the sense of not understanding all the details here. But as far as if you think of an arc, I suppose if you divided a circle into 12 sections, start with that for a moment. We have a circle, or hula hoop. Let's do a hula hoop. That's a circle. And if we divide it into 12 equal sections, you'd have 12 pieces that would be the same, the arc of, they would be identical, essentially, because they would be in an arc, some type of a, they would be arcing like this. Now, there, so what this is getting to as far as the 12, and so it's a sequence of number of letters that go across, and number of letters going down. Now, where it gets confusing is the 12. Whether or not it's actually 12 letters or if it's, but I think the point is it's an equal number of letters going up horizontally and an equal number of letters that go down vertically. And each place, so number of lines, I don't have the precise number. I mean, I can see why it's confusing here because it says on page 111, the word ancho comes from misa, meaning the 12th part. And it's the 12th part of an, when it's the 12th part, it's the 12th part of an arc. Each letter will take up the 12th part of a column. So when you think of a column, I mean this way, we take up a 12th part of it. And so, but, getting, so let me try to illustrate here. Sometimes you have, I'm not sure you can see these creases here. Sometimes, see those three creases? We have three columns here. Other times, they'd have four columns in their work. See, this is one, two, there's three creases, but we have one, two, three, four columns. And so when we have talk about the columns, they're saying 12 letters across. Now I think we do have some illustrations of this in either a facsimile or a photographically reproduced copy of some of these uncial manuscripts, maybe some minuscule manuscripts. And so it says we take up a 12th part of a column. Now when we think of a 12th part of a column, each letter would take up a 12th part of the column.
Sort of big letters.
Or letters in each column. Further, there was generally no space between the words. So it would run across. Now, it does seem to indicate that it would be 12 across. And so, which we can look at that at the class if you want to. With a document in the room, several documents in the room, we could examine that. And there's some documents down in the basement, too, that could be evaluated. But it was equally across. Now, what's interesting is in some instances we have, in the case of, this is not discussed in this chapter, but in the instance of Mark's Gospel, Mark 16, chapter 16, verses 9 to 20, we have examples of them leaving a space, a blank space, where there should be something that would be there, the last 12 verses of Mark. Now, in one instance, we have a document of B and Aleph. One of them is four columns. The other one is three columns. And so, this is a description of the manuscript. Now, I'm not sure if it always was that case, the 12 across, or just in some instances. Now, I'm not sure where the principle of the, unless it's, but usually the arc is concerned. A 12th part of the arc, unless it's related to the papyri, but it seems that they were using the, I'm not sure if all uncials are on papyri, or some of them are on vellum. But when you think of this on papyri, the principle of an ark may be a little bit more understandable, because when we saw that papyri, that sample papyri last time, it looked like a piece of soft, like a balsa wood, like a very piece of soft wood, and that could unpeel. And so when you unpeel something, it's like when you get something that's rolled up in a mail poster or calendar. We'll have these wall calendars that are our year-at-a-glance calendars. And when you unroll it, it doesn't unroll. It kind of wants to go back. And so I think perhaps with papyri, when you would unfold it, it would want to have the tendency to return. So you have that arcing principle. I'm not sure if the unshul, if it's 12th part of it, 12th part of an arc, if that has anything to do with it. Unless you consider that bend in the, if I were to make this, if this were a little bit larger piece of paper, you know, this of course is too small, because I have just one of these, half of it, just 50% of the arc, of this arc here, that covers two columns. But you want to have a 12th. If we made it with a bigger piece of paper, and we would divide it up into 12, you think of a 12th of it, and maybe that's where the 12th is coming from, as far as how to determine how much of the papyri was written on. Perhaps it would be just come naturally as far as how much of it could be written on. But I think it goes more importantly to the uniform number of letters across. And then in the instance of let's see if he gave it. Okay, so he's got 13 letters here. In God so loved the world. Now with these papyri texts, if they followed, they would the E, if they couldn't fit, they would bring it down to the next line, I believe. Tammy.
Did they do, I think there was that chart in a previous section that it showed how they would, it's on page 65, with the, I'm not sure about the angel, yeah, it says with the angel, thus God, G-O-D, would be G-D, and son, S-O-N-S-N, that would, seems like it was with the angel. And they also did that with the minuscules.
Yes.
I mean, there's that little example on the right.
I think it's 18.
All right, got it wrong, okay. But nonetheless, we have your... Did I get your question and someone answered Tammy or not? How many did you get? You have 18?
There's 18.
There's 18?
I don't think he's just showing... He's not... ...run together.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess I am having trouble counting today, too.
You're fine. Okay. I just didn't know what
you're... How many did you count with, Jacob?
I didn't count until you did.
All right. I didn't take my shoes off. I guess I should have. The papyri were used 3rd century, from the 14th century to the 15th century. Most...
Can I ask a question?
Please go.
Is P in all these because it's papyri?
That's exactly right. When we have P 52, P 56...
I didn't catch on to that.
Yeah, those are the papyri manuscripts. The P stands for papyri, or papyrus. Papyrus, papyrus is singular, papyri is plural. Tammy?
Did you say the papyri lasts until the 14th century?
Well...
It seems like you said until the 3rd century.
3rd century, yes, you're right. That's what he said. You're right.
Then it goes on to the 4th.
And that's what the parchments. The parchments were like a tanned animal skin. Those, the parchments, were used from the 14th, rather from the 4th to the 14th centuries.
I thought vellum was animal skin.
Vellum, okay. Vellum is... It is. It is, so...
I thought parchment was more of the...
I understand what you're saying. Vellum. In the first sections...
Yes.
You talked about vellum. Between parchment and vellum.
Yes.
And parchment was more paper.
Yeah. Like,
Well, so if you look over page 115, we have this commission by Constantine. Constantine had at least 50 official Bibles made on high quality parchments or vellum. And so this is on page 111, I believe.
Yeah, I thought you said it was on
113. Well, now it's back to page 111.
It could be written on parchments or vellum.
I'm not saying
that parchments is vellum.
Right, okay. That's right. You're right.
Well, a finer kind of parchment was usually made from calf skin, known as vellum.
Yeah.
Oh.
It's a certain type of parchment, I guess.
No.
Okay. But not all parchments.
And so now that we have the size of the sheet here, from 6 inches by 9 inches or 12 inches by 15 inches, and then we see that they were pasted together in 20 sheets. So you had 20, think of them being, somehow you have these 20 sheets, these aren't the same dimensions, these are 8 and a half by 11 sheets, but you connect them together, you have 20 of them going out this way. And so then you have one roll, what's called a biblios. One more was called a biblos, and then so we have, and so we look.
I thought it was interesting.
Go ahead.
The Greek, they unrolled this way.
Yes.
And the Hebrew ones were this way. The Greek and Latin were this way.
Yes.
So they would actually roll it from the top down, or they would lay them out. That is
interesting, yes. Now page 111, he says, the Greek line horizontally, from left to right. For Hebrew, it went from right to left. The longest books of the New Testament were 50 to 30 feet. Horizontally, though, I still think it's the...
This way.
Horizontally, and think of the horizon.
All right, yeah.
I mean, I do understand.
It's just the direction. Okay,
yes.
Got it.
And so they would the Hebrew, we read from English, we read from left to right, and here in Greek, we read from left to right, Latin, left and right, but Hebrew, they read from,
they read backwards.
From right to left.
From right to left.
Yeah, from right to left. Now, so most of the surviving ones are on the parchment, or the vellum, most of them. And so we see the longest books of the New Testament, the length of them are 30 to 35 feet long. Now,
30 to 55 feet.
30 to 55 feet, okay. Thank you, 30 to 55 feet long.
Reading glasses, what happened?
No, I'm reading just fine here. I'm just, had a computational problem, I suppose. Notice here the greatest change was when the introduction of a codex. And what a codex is more like a bound book, of a book that we're interested, more a book that we're used to. When we think of a book.
At the same time, they made scrolls. They made codexes.
If we look at page 111, obviously it's a scroll very awkward to use. Thus, a proverb developed: a great book is a great evil. Christianity and the desire to spread the word was greatest force that brought about the change from the scroll to the codex or book form, according to Strauss. And so, just like we had the first, what was the first document printed in the printing press?
The
Bible. And see, the force behind the need for having a codex, a bound book, where you have, rather than having all these 20 sheets glued together, and stretching out 20 feet, 35 feet, 55 feet, and being rolled up to roll scroll around. The codex was developed so that it could be, you could still have the sheets, but there would be, you just turn a page, and you get to be what you need to get to, rather than scrolling around. Now, it's interesting to note here about the use of vellum. It says, it is certain that no real second century Christian would have been caught dead with vellum scrolls on him for the high class. So, it continues, revised versions put out by Alexandria, writing the first and second century Bible-believing people, used papyri rolls and codices when they copied. This explained why two papyri copies of TR survived the first three centuries of the Roman persecution. So, the vellum scrolls were identified with corruption. And so that's why the Christians wouldn't even want them. Just think of a poor Bible translations today. Real born again Christians don't want them. As far as if they're really, really corrupt. I mean, they're even the ones that, even the big five, the big four, other than the big, King James is one of the big five, but the other so-called big four, you know, we've seen this before, haven't we? And as far as in our study right now, we have the NIV, the New American, we have New King James, we have the ESV. Those are blindly accepted sometimes by Bible-believing, fundamental, independent, you know, Christians. But the overall point is, there are some that they don't want. That group doesn't want. And see, the point that the reason I brought that up today was the fact that this type of scroll, you know, as far as the vellum scroll, that was a sign that was identified with some type of, specifically that's coming from Alexandria, but they didn't want it. Tammy, would you have a question about something?
Yeah, I do have a question. Please. Because my understanding was the virus itself was from Egypt.
Okay.
Wasn't it? Or did they have the papyrus in Israel? I mean, my understanding was the papyrus was Egyptian material.
I think it's probably a product for the most part from that part of the world. I'm not sure if it goes anyplace else, but they would manufacture this. Doesn't mean they would like sometimes when we were when I was looking around for different types of paper, I was talking about people who told me that a certain Boulier sheet is a very good paper, very good quality paper. It's located in France, the Boulier sheet. It's a French product of France. And one of the best quality Bible paper, get the Boulier sheet. And then you take that from France and you would send that over to the printer or the printers, which is nowhere near France. We didn't go with the Boulier sheet because things just got too complicated and we wanted to be economical in the whole project and for time constraints too. And so it's possible that they were able to import papyri, maybe the raw material or maybe the finished paper product. I don't know for sure. Go ahead.
But couldn't they use other animal skins?
I mean, yes, they could have.
Because it wasn't like they were in poverty for animal skins.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, as far as the Jews, I mean, and a lot of the early Christians came from the Jewish tradition. I don't know. This was a little bit of a surprise to me. That's why I was asking.
Mm-hmm.
I was just wondering if they couldn't have found a use for the skins.
Yes.
That they never used before. You know, and actually had a different type of skin. Perhaps it was less expensive or something.
I guess the overall point is your, it says rather, near the bottom of page 111, rather, the first and second century Bible-believing people used papyrus rolls and codices, which they copied. This explains why few papyrus copies of the TR survived the first three centuries of the Roman persecution. And so I guess it does come to your. We have to address the point of as far as where they get the papyrus from.
Well, do we know that they didn't survive past the 3rd century just because we don't have them now?
Oh, that's true. No, we don't know when they...
They could have survived till the 10th century.
Yes, they could have. But they usually, what's been discussed here, they would just destroy the exemplar once you had a copy made.
Right.
You know, so, but yeah, it could have a longer life. I mean, we see examples of them even being survived into this century, certain papyri.
The point was, I thought that they used them. That's why the different texts and manuscripts survived, because they were corrupted and
yes.
they weren't used,
mm-hmm.
and they were just stored away.
Yes, that's true as well. I mean, I'm not sure what Strauss is thinking.
No, this is
Ruckman. What Ruckman is thinking when he says this, but that's what he's trying to put forth this thinking. To think, and I'm not sure what. Yeah, I'm sure he's got some basis for it.
We're talking about a soul winner here.
Yes.
Wouldn't carry. He would have had carried a New Testament with him.
Okay.
He said.
Mm-hmm.
They do that. There's really not too many rolls of these things. You can see how hard it was to get the Bible anywhere near you.
And so now we have the five uncials. Aleph, Alexandrius, Canis, and C and D. So it's Aleph, A, B, C, and D. These are the five that they like. That are supposed to be considered superb in some way or the other.
But they aren't, right?
No, they're not. And so of the 267, they pick out these five, or five favorites.
Not a very high percentage.
No, they're not. It's not. And so...
What's 267 have to do with that?
That's how many there are. How many Uncial manuscripts are.
Okay.
And among those 267, they pick out, oh, we like these five. We like these five. Now, it's interesting to note that Sinaiticus contains parts of the Old Testament, including the Epistle of Barnabas and the Shepherd of Hermas. And we see that this was discovered by Tischendorf in 1844. This particular manuscript, Sinaiticus, in one of the locations that's alleged to be Mount Sinai, which it's likely to be the wrong Mount Sinai, but nonetheless, the monastery, St. Catherine's Monastery, is where it is. They put the monastery by the base of the wrong mountain. But nonetheless, Tischendorf found it there. Something that was in order in line to be destroyed, we could burn up in the furnace, and then in time it was sold to the Russians, then to the British Museum in 1933, which is the last century. Some people we know are living in 1933 when this sale was made.
It was made after the Bolshevik Revolution.
Yes, that's right. It was after. Which
yeah,
was 1917.
They wanted everything Christian
yep.
out of that country.
They did. They got rid of it. They sold it to the Brits.
Someone in this room was alive in 1933.
Yes.
It was you.
That's right.
Alive.
Does anyone know anyone? You may know somebody in this room today
yeah,
with
I'm
us.
I'm figuring it out.
What's that?
I'm figuring it out.
You figuring out who it was?
It's me. It's
okay.
I. But I figured it out. I think it's six. Is it right? 1927 minus 1993 minus 1927.
Is that
six?
Yes, you were 6 years old.
I was getting out of the hospital.
Yes.
What happened then?
When the Russians, or in fact the Soviets, sold the
it was sold to the Russians.
No, the Russians had. Tischendorf gave it to the Russians, and then the Russians became the Soviets.
It was sold to the Russians.
It was sold to the Russians.
And then
yeah, the Tsar wanted
it.
Given
to the British Museum.
No, the British Museum purchased it. They bought it.
Okay.
From Russia.
From the Soviets.
From the Soviets.
This text is a mixture of Alexandrian and Western. Strauss says that. I don't know how he knows that.
So that's text families, right?
Yes.
That he's referring to?
I think it is. Mm-hmm. Notice what it says on page 113, it says, it is commonly said to be the only Ancho manuscript which contains the entire New Testament, but it must be remembered that it omits John 5, verses 4 to 4, John 8, verses 1 to 14, Matthew 16, 2 and 3, Romans 16, 24, and Mark 16, 9 to 20. Look at these verses that are being omitted, over 17 of them here that are being omitted, and hundreds of other words or phrases which are commonly removed from the Alexandrian text. And so it's interesting, I think he said here, and I'll say it now in case I forget to say it later, is when you compare B and Aleph, you can't even read two verses together without them having disagreement, which is an interesting observation that you can remember. Now listen to Hort's conclusion. He says, Hort concluded that the scribes of Avicannus reached by no means a high standard of accuracy. Now how false is that? Were they accurate or were they inaccurate, these scribes of Avicannus? What's Hort thinking when he says this?
Well, who's the good guy? The Vaticanus or the...
Well, is Hort, let me ask, does Hort wear a black hat or a white hat?
He wears a black hat.
Well, actually,
he's
probably wears a white hat, he's a black dude inside.
Yes.
he's corrupt himself.
Yes.
So he believes in the corrupt scribes.
Right. The catalog designation for Vatican is B, right?
Mm-hmm.
B is a text of origin, the text of Westcott Hort. It's a bad text, and so West Hort is a bad guy for picking a bad text, and Hort's cohort Westcott is also equally bad. But we have the bad cast. We have it's filled with corruption. It's full with corruption. But look, he says his conclusion is that, you know, they reached the noble by no means the highest standard of accuracy.
Accuracy in their point of view.
Right.
Not in our point of view.
Right, exactly. No. Right. We know it's inaccurate. According to Hort's twisted thinking, mm-hmm. he thinks it's accurate.
Right. He's not fooled by it. He's part of the deception.
Yes, That's right, he is. And when we think of what Brogan says, he says, using the TR as a basis of comparison, Brogan found that Sinaiticus, in the four Gospels alone, omits 3,455 words. And we have someone we know here that's mentioned here on page 113, don't we?
Mm-hmm. That's who said this.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Then when we go on, and it says, it is common today to read that the given modern translation, consider the NIV preface, or Greek text, is based on an eclectic text.
Where are you at?
On page 114.
We're talking about Vaticanus
now? Yes. Mm-hmm. So,
we should mention that person is Dr. D.A. Wade.
Yes, we should. Some of you may know him.
I think all of us.
Well, there we have at least two or three people who are watching today, households that are watching today. Thank you for doing the class today. He is.
Okay.
Yes.
Let me quote what he said.
Okay, please do.
It is found that at least 10 revisers between the 4th and 12th centuries busied themselves with the task of correcting its many and extraordinary perversions of the truth of Scripture. That's the end of the quote.
And all his numbers, those are all his numbers in the previous paragraph.
Yes, that's
from
right.
From his book, An Answer to Stuart Custer. And it shows...
Why don't you read the numbers?
Okay, it says, using the TR as a basis of comparison, Bergan found... Sinaiticus in four Gospels alone omitted 3,455 words added 839, substituted 1,114, transposed 2,299, modified 1,265. Thus, in all, 8,972 words are affected.
Well, thank you for reading that.
That reminds me of that other book, 8,000 Differences.
Yes, that's good. Thus, now, so, again, the main pillars are Vatican and Sinai. Vatican being an Aleph, which is Sinai. Or maybe not, which is Vatican B.
Sinaiticus.
Sinaiticus, which is Aleph. Aleph is the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet. And so these are the two main pillars that the West Convert are using, and that they like. And of course, they don't. These two manuscripts, they don't agree with each other at all. They have contradictions among each other. And so how can you have them be your key pillars when they're not equal? Mm-hmm. You know, they're not equal. What kind of foundation is that built on something unequal pillars? It's a horrible foundation. And we notice here, Vaticanus was also in around 350 or 370. In other words, that's the age of the paper, they believe. And it's been in the Vatican Library since 1481. It contains most of the Old Testament. So how's that? And most of the New Testament, except for parts of Hebrews, the pastoral epistles, and Revelation. And it's somewhat of a mixed text, according to Thomas Strauss.
Now where are we?
On page 114. It contains the epistle to Barnabas and the Apocrypha. Mm. It contains the Apocrypha and the epistle of Barnabas, and plus the parts of the Old Testament. That could be very disturbing, I suppose. Having that Apocrypha in there and this Epistle Barnabas. And again, they call it neutral. The Westcom are calling this a neutral text. Tammy.
Is it my understanding that what he was saying at the beginning of this section was that this particular pillar was the basis of the all the modern critical texts?
Yes.
More so than Sinaiticus, then.
I think so, yeah.
So that's interesting.
Mm-hmm. And so we have here, you know, he believes it came from Italy. It was described from Italy that did this, and he called it a neutral text. I'm not sure if it was Italy or if it was Egypt or where it was, but nonetheless, it's not necessarily neutral. It's very, very slanted, very biased to error. That's what it is. We know, as we said before, there are, just in the Gospels alone, there are 3,000 differences for B and L. Just in the Gospels alone, we have there are these 3,000 real differences in the Gospels alone. Now, Kenyon, on page 115, Kenyon says it was written early in the 5th century. This is going back to Alexandrius, early 5th century. This is the third of the 5th century with writing, B letters, and characters, then B or Aleph. It's missing much of Matthew and part of John and 2 Corinthians. It, that is Alexandrius, or A, attaches two of the epistles of Clement to the end of the canonical books. With regard to its place or origin, everything points to Alexandria, Egypt. So, again, this A text, the Alexandrian text, is again a problem text. He says on page 116, the arrival of this text, the Alexandrian text, in Europe 16 years after the publication of the Authorized Version gave first stimulus toward the criticism of the text. And that's what the critic considers this a tragedy that arrived 16 years too late. However, this, the Bible believer, and see the providence of God denying its arrival until the Authorized Version was safely in the hands of His people. Mm-hmm. And he quoted in Acts, after the second or third editions, seven editions of it, it still was not even considered to be included. And then we have got C, and we have D as well. As far as these are the texts. So we have B, Aleph, A, C, and D. Now, on page 116, Strauss says the text is mixed but a pro-Byzantium. Kenyon, as we would expect, speaks of this Byzantine presence being due to its correctors. Borgon would rank the codex behind Alexandrius as having the fewer corruptions among the five old unctions. On page 116, I believe. I'm sorry, am I losing everybody?
No, just me.
Okay.
Yeah, the two in the back row are lost.
Okay, all right, good. That's not good.
That's
not good. I'm very...
Lost.
I don't want you to be lost.
Just repeat what you said, so okay. Maybe I can find it.
Strauss, so we're talking about Ephraim Receptus, C. See that there on page 116? You go down a little bit near the part of the end of that paragraph. Strauss says the text is mixed but pro-Byzantium. Mm-hmm. You don't see that?
I think you're talking about, you're on page 116?
116.
I thought you were talking about Ephraim Receptus. You just said that.
Well, Strauss is at the beginning of 116, about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 lines down.
Yeah, that's on A. Are you on A? Alexandrinus?
This is A, I suppose. I mean, we have C also.
I think
he's talking about A.
I'm asking which one you're talking about.
I think I'm either talking about C or A.
Well, let me know so I can follow.
Okay, all right.
Where does R come in?
We haven't got there yet.
Okay.
So, Ephraim Receptus. It's the Ephraim Receptus right before D. Do you see where Strauss is quoting there?
No, Strauss isn't talking there.
He has a Byzantine text on the Gospels and Alexandria elsewhere. Strauss.
That's for Alexandrinus.
This is A. Okay, so I guess he's talking about A then. I'm sorry. I thought it was A originally. Now looking here in the chronology, we have C above it. So that's why I'm mixing everybody up in the back row.
C is after it.
Okay.
In our book.
It's okay.
I'm just mixed up.
No, you're not mixed up. I'm the one that's mixed up. So, and we have C, we have D, we have D according to the source here. It was presented to Cambridge by the great Reformation scholar Theodore Beza. Now, this has to be looked into a little bit further as far as this D text, but it is a case of a good man with a very bad manuscript. Which, if it's true, that would be true. Now, noticing here, we have on page 118, its format is different. This is talking about D than others. The page size is much smaller, measuring 10 by 8 inches. So it's smaller than our typical piece of paper here in this country, which is 8.5 inches by 11 inches. Not much smaller, but about the same size than in the first extant example of New Testament being written in two languages, Greek and Latin. So you have both languages here presented in manuscript D. Continuing over on page 118, the extent of Latin text is sufficient proof itself. The manuscript was written in the west of Europe, where Latin was the language of literature and daily life. So by the very fact that it contains Latin is giving you an indication of where perhaps the likelihood that it was transcribed at over there in west of Europe.
This is a Western text.
Yes.
Supposedly.
Right, supposedly. And so, again, the five old angels, the five old Angelos, and we have them restated there on page 119. And we will continue on with what Bergen says on page 119. Notice how the above, Bergen comments on the evidence sums up the sordid state of affairs that modern textual criticism has brought us to. He says, "We venture to assure you without a particular hesitation that Aleph, B, and D are the three most scandalous corrupt copies extant. They have become the depositories of the largest amount of fabricated readings, ancient blunders, and intentional perversions of truth, which are discoverable in any known copies of the Word of God." And so this is Bergen's observation, what he thinks about B, Aleph, and D. And we don't want to take the naturalistic position. We don't want to be forced into that position. He says, like Sir Frederick Kenyon says, "Our Bible and the ancient manuscripts is an authoritative presentation of the transmission of Scripture from the naturalistic portion." And again, Kenyon is wrongly, I think, identifying as a naturalistic approach to the Word of God. Then we talked about other manuscripts, D2, E2. In regard to E2, he says, despite his bias against the received text, they think it's less valuable, not important, he is forced to concede that most of the Unschels are that kind of text.
Where
are we? We're on page 120. We skipped over some of these other documents, you know, we talked about them real quick, about the D2, the EEV2, and there are other ones.
So, can you repeat what you just said when you started this section?
You should probably take this slower.
Okay, I'll take it slower.
I don't really, but I mean,
yeah, and you left out R.
I left out R, you're sorry.
Not you.
And you as well.
I meant in the original thing, we should probably should take it 2 weeks per chapter.
Okay.
Next time.
We can consider that. Page 120.
120.
He says, Sir Frederick, actually maybe on the end of 119, beginning of 120. Sir Frederick Kenyon's Our Bible and Our Ancient Manuscripts, that's the name of his book, is an authoritative presentation of the transmission of Scripture from the naturalistic position. It first came out in 1895 and has gone through a number of revisions and editions. The copy, he's in talks about which copy he reads from, but then he goes on and says about Kenyon. Says, the Bible believer will be very interested to hear what Kenyon or his revisor has to say on page 213. After discussing in detail the five essentials, he first discloses three others. And he says, talks about Kenyon, he says, how he takes a naturalistic approach. And he's got these five others, the D2, the E, the E2, and what are the other ones? But he takes these other positions. The Washington, the Washington manuscript, which is, and then, on page 42, this is where he says this. He says, Sir Frederick Kenyon says, Our Bible and ancient manuscripts is an authoritative presentation of the transmission of Scriptures from a naturalistic position. So Kenyon is taking a wrong view of having a natural position. And here we get R.
Where are you now?
On page 120. R. Again, this is akin to Aleph. We have T, which is supposed to relate to Aleph. Got Z manuscript Z, which is many agreement, has a lot of agreement with Aleph. You got Z, XXI, again, it's akin to B. And so we have all these other kind of offshoot manuscripts, or parts of manuscripts, that are agreeing with B and Aleph and Alexandrian of the five, which are themselves the corrupt. usually they come back to this, there's two pillars, the B and Aleph. And when they're agreeing with B and Aleph, that's not necessarily a positive thing. That's a negative thing for them to be in agreement with B or Aleph. He says over on page 121, but out of well over 200 unshuls, these on the page 121, it starts with, now there are many others.
Okay.
And there were one or two instances where similar portions of manuscripts, some Alexandrian readings, for example, Codex Lectionaries, but out of the well over 200 unshuls, these were all that Kenyon and his later revisers were prepared to mention. You know, like Custer picking out, what is it, 8 or 9 of them, of his, back in the last section. Further, the very marked conflict between Aleph and B is magnified much further when support is sought from those six unshuls. So the discrepancy is magnified. Magnified. Get a question?
Well, I didn't want to upset. I don't know where we are.
Page 121.
Page 121 about Mark Manor Baptist Church. I think that's that debate.
Yes.
That Custer had.
Yeah, we're not quite there.
We're in the first paragraph.
Go ahead and tell what it says. Tell us what he said. Custer said. How the well worse the Bob preserved? What did Custer say? How Mark had a Manor Baptist Church?
I don't remember.
Keep on reading.
At Marpet Manor Baptist Church in Chicago, 1984, Dr. Custer said that God preserved his word in the sands of Egypt. No, God did not preserve his words in the sands of Egypt, or on a library shelf in the Vatican Library, or in a waste paper bin in a Catholic monastery at the foot of Mount Sinai. The author here. God did not preserve his word in the disusing, but in the using. He did not preserve the words by it being stored away at the buried, but rather through the use of transmission in the hands of a humble believer. The good copies were worn out, the corrupted ones were put on the shelf. And to repeat what Kursoff Lake said, it is hard to resist the conclusion that the scribes usually destroyed their exemplars when they had copied the sacred books. Yet, despite this, there is the same clear evidence from the earlier unshuls as there is from the papyri. Kenyon's books list the following pre-7th century manuscripts as being on the side of the received text, though as his statement shows, he doesn't seem to be very happy to admit it. That's interesting. That evidently was a...
The late Dr. Bumpus' church, the American Avenue Baptist Church.
Must have been a headlight time, this debate. The only thing, you know what I mean? I don't know what to say. I'll say a time to be remembered.
Right, yeah, that's available. I do a search for that. It's online, in fact.
And Dr. Waite was debating Custer.
And yes, that's correct.
And then the man that was my husband's assistant didn't know how to debate. All he did was give positive things. All he did was give the side, you know, like introductory stuff. So Dr. Waite was left to refute everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Because whatever that man's name was, he didn't know how he was supposed to refute. He didn't know how to debate. He just gave positive. I don't know how to explain it. You know what I mean?
I know. Yeah, I
know. Thank you for explaining it. It's mentioned in here.
Yeah, that is interesting. It is very interesting. Now, notice on page 121, he says, this is near the bottom of the paragraph, in Acts and in the Epistle Codex A, agree most closely with the Alexandrian text of B and Aleph type, but the Gospels, it agrees generally with the traditional text. Thus, the Gospel Codex A testifies to the antiquity of the traditional text, so it's kind of a mixed.
Yeah,
page 121.
I know that.
Okay, we're on. It starts out, the paragraph starts out with A, Alexandria's 5th century.
Okay, you've gone and, away from where you were before.
Okay, I guess I thought she read most of that paragraph.
I know, but there was some other, you were at the first paragraph.
Go ahead.
Okay, probably it was, but then I got my lost my place here. So we have, at the beginning, we see here, we're talking about the unshuls, the papyri, Kenyon's books list the following pre-17th century manuscripts as being on the side of received texts. So Kenyon is agreeing that there are some of these papyri that are on the side of the received texts. A lot of them, more than some, a lot of them are on the side of it. And we talked about this A, how it agrees, would be an Aleph type of text. You see where we're at, Tammy? You want to put it?
Maybe. Are you in A? I was
in bottom 121.
I thought you went back up to the top of the page.
Okay, I'll go.
No, you don't need to. You said you lost your place.
Okay, we'll go back to the top.
So then I thought you were going to go back.
Okay, I'm sorry. We'll go back.
I'm just very confused.
We'll go back. I don't want to be confused. We'll go back to the top of page 121. Now, we see that there are well over 200 uncials. We're back to the page, top of page 121. Over 200 uncials. These were all that Kenyon had in his letter, letter revisers were prepared to mention. So we get 200 of them, but it only mentions five and then maybe a couple other sub ones. But out of over 200, he only gives reference to five of them. Further, the very marked conflict between Aleph, B, and A, it's magnified much further when support is sought from these six uncials. So the six uncials don't help B and Aleph any. It makes it even worse. Makes it even worse.
So there's nine altogether.
Yes. Nine conflicting manuscripts which early Christians didn't bother to use out of over 200 uncials doesn't present any stronger use of the non-papyri than Custer mentions. Or eight conflations that Hort talks about. And this is where we're talking about this event, this debate Mark had in the Baptist Church with Bumpus, Dr. Bumpus, how Dr. Custer says, God preserved his words in the sands of Egypt. That's what the context is on page 121. And yet we see here, later on page 120, yet despite this, there is the same clear evidence from the earlier uncials as there are from the papyri. So uncial support, papyri support, that is not supporting the Westcott-Hort type of text, the text of origin, but it's supporting the received text for the most part. Clear evidence, he says. So the clear evidence, with using the uncials and the papyri, that there is support. Moving down to the bottom of, near the bottom of this page 121, there's this second last paragraph, I guess, maybe in the middle of the paragraph, or the last paragraph. It says, in Acts and the Epistles, Codex A agrees most closely with the Alexandrian type of text. And so this is an example of a split text. He's got another name for it than a split text. Agrees more closely with the Alexandrian text of B, an Aleph type, but in the Gospels, so in the Epistles, we have more agreement with B and Aleph, but in the Gospels, there's agreement with the received text. Thus, in the Gospels, Codex A testifies to the antiquity of the traditional texts. And so we have the date, and we have the Washington manuscript. It's found in Washingtonius Manuscript W, which is found in Washington, D.C., at the Freer Gallery there in Washington, D.C. We should go there next time you're in Washington. Next time you're in Washington, you can go there and see where it is.
Where is it in Washington again?
The Freer Gallery of Art.
And so, and when we look here, on page 122 again, the discovery of W tends to disprove the theses of Westcott-Hort that the traditional text is fabricated text, which was put together in the 4th century. But a group of scholars residing in Antioch, by a group of scholars in Antioch, that's the false theory of Westcott-Hort. For Codex W is a very ancient manuscript, and we have Grenfell regards it as probably 4th century. And so we have here the manuscript W that has some TR support being dating to the 4th century. So it disproves that the theory of Westcott North, that it was conflation or fabrication that was going on, that Westcott North says was going on. And we then, and give support to the text receptus. O is text receptus. Cigna is text receptus. Phi is text receptus. He says here on page 123, he says, to those, we may add, the vast majority of remaining Unschel manuscripts, right, this total is 207, and most of several hundred Unschels fragments, I believe the number is 2320, and that was placed in 1980. So we have a whole lot of...
1950. You need glasses.
Oh, it's okay, 1950. Somebody made a mistake. Either me or them or they, or how much you made a mistake.
You had a trouble seeing.
I saw it perfectly. But my number's a different number for some reason. I'm not sure why.
You're failing you.
Because you didn't have glasses when you wrote it up.
Okay, maybe not. That's
you need glasses.
What? Well, I have someplace, I suppose. So that concludes our discussion about the survey of Unschel manuscripts. Again, just the thing with the papyri, the same idea, you know, almost the same idea, just different, over different names of manuscripts. So, Mrs. Gorman, what are your thoughts about the today's class?
I'm gonna pass right now.
Okay, you're allowed to. How about you, Jacob?
Everybody else is
going to
be allowed to somehow.
But you can't, though, Jacob.
Okay.
So you're from Texas. You can't pass.
What? So
she.
You know, this is
doesn't work.
This is so much in this book, and you know what? In a few ways, I was thinking this is way more than it was, you know. But that's all right. There's a lot of there's a few of these places in this book like this, but this is not so hard. There's so much evidence here. It's ridiculous way. This isn't the main issue in most churches, anyway.
No, it's not. Right. Well, your thoughts.
This is actually a demonstration for us, I think. God promised to preserve his words.
He did.
And he's showing us that he's preserving his words.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't keep secrets.
No, he doesn't.
Everything is made visible to us,
mm-hmm.
You know, and he's the extent of which he goes to proving himself is just incredible. It's far beyond what any human could possibly do.
Mm-hmm.
But I think, what can you say?
That's right. Mom, your thoughts about this? Were you finished, Paul?
No, I'm just going to say, you know, we'll be studying this issue too when we go to be with the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
We will be sitting at His feet studying this stuff. And of course, we got all of eternity to learn it, so we don't have to rush through.
That's right. How many thoughts about this class?
Well, I remember when that debate was going on, the other man, I don't remember his name, really the one that should have been debated.
Price, right? No, James Price and Stuart Custard and Jim Corallo.
Corallo. And the one that should have been debating with Dad should have been Dr. Thomas Strauss, but he wasn't allowed to because he was teaching at
Maranatha Baptist Bible College.
And Cederholm, was that his name?
Cederholm.
And he...
Or the other
he
one.
He didn't want to... say anything against Bob Jones. He couldn't say anything. The people that knew the material real well and knew how to debate weren't allowed to be with Dr. Wade.
Mm-hmm.
They couldn't because it was bad for their school.
Mm-hmm. Well,
what Mrs. Wade has just said hits the nail on the head on a lot of issues. Their loyalties were more to their institutions that they were involved with than to the Word of God.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Mm-hmm. Well, Dr. Cederholm verbally took a good stand for the received text and everything. And he told Dr. Wade, you can say anything you want when you're teaching. It doesn't matter what you say. So he mentioned Bob Jones University and how they had a different position on the text.
Mm-hmm.
And he recommended Dr. Wade.
Mm-hmm.
But he'd already given him a clear bit of help. I guess he didn't know what he was talking about.
Mm-hmm.
That's sort of strange.
Yeah, it's strange. I think they had a merge with another school, which merged with another school. I'm positive about that.
I can't remember if they merged with anybody or not.
I'm not sure either. Tammy, your thoughts. Do you have your thoughts? Finally, your thoughts?
I had another thought, but I lost it, and I don't know where it is.
Well, you find that, let us know. Tammy?
I lost earlier.
It's just interesting, the minority of... We're looking at the actual textual documents, and it's like the minority of quote-unquote evidence supporting
mm-hmm.
these other texts
right.
are
mm-hmm.
minuscule. And then, he mentioned also the evidence
mm-hmm.
of the conflation, where there were only eight. They could only find the eight examples of that.
Mm-hmm.
So everything that they've said doesn't hold any water. So the family and the genealogy and close copying and all that, obviously we know that, but
mm-hmm.
Being able to look at these three different things that, with the papyri evidence, the ozeal evidence, and then going back to the kind of the whole pillars that they were talking about before about their accusations
mm-hmm.
of conflation, and that's why there's so many of them, and because of the they were copying them. And,
mm-hmm.
The recension, that means that they went back and they changed it later, or what was that? Can you remind me of that? The Lucian recension?
I mean, they took part of here, part of here, and part of here. Part from here, and they didn't go into here, they got part of from here, and part from here, and part from here. Any more thoughts?
No, that's it.
Anna, your thoughts?
The word of God still stands.
Yes.
And no matter all the attacks that are leveled against it,
it does. That's right. Anyone have any thoughts or questions, observations about this discussion today? Well, Bill, would you please close your prayer?
Father in heaven, we thank you for giving us your word and preserving it for us so that we can study it and know what you want us to know, learn to understand all of these things. We thank you for the opportunities that we have to learn the truth about the Bible, to separate the evil words from the good words, and that we can arrive at the truth because that is the only thing that really matters. How people tend to conceive of things in their own hearts is a problem that they have. They don't understand it. But they are so bent on what they want and in their lives in this world, whereas a true Bible believer only wants the Word of God, and we want it exactly as you have given it to us. And we believe that we have that Word in our King James Bible. Father, we thank you for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right, so.